So Sanskritization is a very important topic in your examination. Okay, so it can be asked from 10 marker to 20 marker. So what is Sanskritization and how is it useful in understanding caste mobility or social change in India can be asked. So when they ask contribution of M.N. Srinivas or Indian anthropologist, there also you might have to write few points on Sanskritization. Now Sanskritization is a model to understand caste mobility or social mobility or group mobility in Indian society. It's a model to understand caste mobility or group mobility in Indian social system. Okay, so it was given by M.N. Srinivas. Okay, so we'll try to understand what it is. Before that, there are few examples. If you put this case studies, you will understand. So the Chammars are one of the scheduled caste. Now among the Chammars, during the wedding, there were rituals where they sacrificed pig. But pig, sacrifice of the pig, etc. may not be considered to be very pure, pure and pollution. So pig and it is equated to pollution, right? So now they were sacrificing pig. But because it was, they were degraded because of this, what they did was they gave away this practice of sacrificing the pig. Instead, it was replaced with cutting of nutmeg as a ritual. Okay, yes. Nutmeg is arcade, yes. So cutting of nutmeg. Similarly, they had bride price among them. Okay. But dowry system was started to be emulated because dowry system is seen among the upper caste. Okay, the lower castes are mainly egalitarian, women, everybody is treated equally. So bride price was replaced with dowry. Okay. Similarly, weddings were now being provided, I mean the service was provided by Brahmins. They started going to pilgrimage. There were elaborate death rituals, Shraddha, etc. were practiced by Chamar. And with the idea of if they practice all of this, emulate the upper caste, they can claim themselves to be upper caste. Understood? Similarly, in Mysore also, the lower caste of Mysore started to adopt the ways of Lingayats. They started calling themselves to as Vishwakarma Brahmins. They changed their name. That's also why this example is for you to understand that what are the various factors or how do they try to Sanskritize. Either they follow the upper caste ways or they even try to change their name, outer appearance at least, so that they can claim themselves upper caste. They started to wear sacred thread and follow Brahminical rituals so that over generation they can claim themselves as upper caste. So many lower caste across India, okay, they follow the upper caste ka clothing, food, they give up non-vegetarianism and take up vegetarianism, cooking pattern, cooking style, okay, jewelries, rituals, they change their name, okay, teetotalism, that means giving up alcohol. All these practices were done so that they can claim themselves as upper caste. If you see, even today, okay, for example, the Rajputs or the Kshatriyas or the upper caste, the groom comes in horse, yes, Bharat, to take the Bharat and go, they come in horse. So, but it was only restricted to the Kshatriya class, they come in horse, okay. But many lower castes are today trying to follow that practice. And it is not that the upper caste is keeping quiet. There is resistance from them also. Like how can you use horse? Many in places like Rajasthan, UP, there have been violence when the lower caste try to take the bride in palanquin or try to bring the groom in horses. They are not allowed to come in horses or use the main road. I mean, this is a news article. Caste stigma, how Dalit bridegroom on horse challenges status quo. They are trying to go with it. When the upper caste is saying you cannot go, they are trying to do it so that they can assert themselves as equals or superior. Okay. So all these examples point us to show that there has been attempt by the lower caste in order to move up the social hierarchy. This has been studied by anthropologists. Okay. Various words have been or various terms were used to understand this pattern. So initially, even M.N. Srinivas used the word Brahminization. He said that when the lower caste follows the Brahmins. But then he came across other models where the lower caste were not following Brahmins, but other upper caste like Kshatriyas or Vaishyas, etc. Then he found that okay, this Brahminization is not enough to explain social change because they were following other castes also. Plus, Brahminization was restricted to Vedic culture and many other Hindu traditions are not related to only Vedic tradition. So therefore, instead of using the Brahminization, he replaced it with Sanskritization. Initially, he called it Brahminization, but later he then changed it to Sanskritization. Then in one of the seminars, they thought that, okay, instead of using Sanskritization, let's try to, I mean, there was a debate that can we use Hinduization, okay. But again, Hinduization was not useful as a term because it considered the lower caste outside Hindu fold. You know, so they are not Hindus. If they follow the upper caste, then they become Hindu was a wrong idea. It gave a wrong idea and it indicated conversion. Something like, oh, Hinduization means conversion. So it was having a negative tone to it. So they did not use the word Hinduization. Some other said that no, no, it is nothing but acculturation. What is acculturation? Acculturation is process of social change. Okay, acculturation means when I adopt your culture, it is acculturation. When people follow others, like for example, Western, we see Western movies and we follow their lifestyle, that is acculturation. Here also it's the same thing. Lower caste are following the upper caste. Correct, no? The acculturation could have been used, which is already in practice. Why another word, Sanskritization? But again, why Sanskritization? Because acculturation is a very general term. It's a very broad term to include any social change. Here, we are trying to understand social mobility or caste mobility under the Indian social system. Because acculturation is too general as a word, we stick to the word Sanskritization. Okay, so this is the brief background of Sanskritization, the term, how it came into existence. Now, for your exam, you have to know all these points. Who gave it? What is the definition? You should have that crystal clear definition. The reasons, why is the lower caste trying to or undergoing Sanskritization? What is the conditions? Different models to understand Sanskritization. What happens when they undergo Sanskritization? What is the change that happens in the caste when it undergoes Sanskritization? What are the factors that favors Sanskritization and evaluation of criticism of Sanskritization? Okay, so these things can be asked in different ways. Critically evaluate the concept of Sanskritization or what are the changes that occurs due to Sanskritization. All these things can be asked in your examination. Okay, so we'll start one by one. Now, as I already told you, who gave this concept? It was given by M.N. Srinivas. So, M.N. Srinivas was trying to understand the reality of caste system. He wanted to understand whether, I mean, he wanted to differentiate from the book view. The book view said that there is no mobility. Whereas he, after undertaking field work, he stressed that caste mobility was taking place. So while explaining caste mobility, M.N. Srinivas gives this concept of Sanskritization in his book, The Religion and Society Among the Kurds of South India. So he defined the Sanskritization as a process whereby the lower caste or other groups like scheduled tribes also or tribals taking over the customs, rituals, belief, ideology and lifestyle of the higher caste or twice born. Dvija caste is known as Sanskritization. Very simple. It is lower caste or other groups like tribes taking over the customs, rituals, belief, ideology and lifestyle of the higher caste or upper caste is known as Sanskritization. As I told you, initially Brahminization was used. But later when M.N. Srinivas found that, initially when he did study, he saw that the lower caste were following the Brahmins. But then later when he studied more villages or more area regions, he found that they were following other castes also. Like in some places they were following Kshatriyas, in some places they were following Vaishyas. So then he came up with this term as Sanskritization. Okay, fine. Now, what is the reason behind Sanskritization? So as I already told you, one of the prime reason behind this is status elevation. So by following or by doing what the upper caste do, or appearing like upper caste, or naming themselves as upper caste, what can they do? They can claim themselves also as upper caste. So the prime motive behind it was social elevation or status elevation, mobility. Okay, this is what M.N. Srinivas also says. But other anthropologists like Harold Dow says that he found that one of the major reasons for them is to express a challenge against the upper caste. I told you that time I put a case study, you know, that riding on the horse. So they are not allowed to do it. Now they are questioning why not. And they, as a matter of challenge, they are trying to follow the upper caste way. So Harold Dow says it shows how the oppressed is taking over the institution of the oppressor. You understood? They are taking over the institution of the oppressor. Okay, so they are trying to express its challenge. So today, if you see in many areas in Rajasthan, UP, Bihar, and other states also, the lower caste, as a matter of challenge, they are trying to take up this upper caste practices. Is that understood? Now, then what is the condition, precondition for Sanskritization? That the imitating class should consider those castes which it is following as ritually higher, okay, or superior. The imitating caste should consider the caste which it is trying to imitate as superior. Correct, no? So they should consider them to be superior, only then they will be following them. There should be social contact. They should be close. They should be close. There should be a willpower on the lower caste to increase their social status. There should be willpower. That means they would want to increase their social status by doing anything. They should be ready to give up non-vegetarianism or give up any of their practices so that they can elevate socially. This is a precondition. So they should consider the caste that they are emulating as superior. They should be in close social contact with them, and they should have the willpower to elevate socially. Okay, so that is the precondition for them. Now, M.N. Srinivas undertook several studies to bring out different models of Sanskritization. Okay, so one is Brahmin model. So in Brahmin model, he observed that you have to give up non-vegetarian. Okay, so vegetarianism, doing away with widow, remarriage, wearing of sacred thread. Okay, then following purity and pollution. Okay, and chanting Vedic mantras, giving up defiling occupation, hiring the service of Brahmins, doing various rituals like Shraddha, etc. All these things were under Brahminization. And he gives example also. For example, the Lingayats, okay, of Karnataka, they started to follow Shaivism, okay, and claimed themselves to be pure and come up in the social hierarchy. Okay, they were, you know, during the, if you see medieval history of Karnataka, you'll understand. So the castes which were considered to be lower, they, in order to elevate socially, started this movement, Lingayat movement. Okay, so they started claiming themselves as upper caste, okay, by following Shaivism. Similarly, the Smith, I told you earlier, they changed their name itself to Vishwakarma Brahmins and tried to claim themselves as Brahmins. The Kauris of UP, they were once hunters, but now they have given up non-vegetarianism and they have taken up Brahmin ways of life. And now they themselves don't accept food from the Brahmins to maintain themselves as superior. Okay, similarly, the Chammas, etc. Okay, so which we discussed earlier. So they would sacrifice pig, but now they don't. Okay, so all this is an example of Brahminical model. That means these castes adopted Brahmin ways in order to claim themselves as higher. Similarly, he also observed Kshatriya model. Kshatriya model, wearing of sacred thread, limited non-vegetarianism, shift in their occupation, ban and widow remarriage, change in the dressing pattern, adopting pompous living, worshipping Vedic deity, learning martial skills. All these were examples of the Kshatriya model. So example, Kuts of South India or Nadas of South India, the Marathas also. Okay, so Marathas, as I told you, they were originally Shudras. So they during Shivaji's time adopted the Kshatriya ways. Okay, and then you have Kayasthas of UP. They also followed the Kshatriyas and claimed themselves to be Kshatriyas. Next, Vaishya model. Vaishya model is similar to Brahmin model. Okay, so like giving up non-vegetarianism, okay, all that. Same like Brahmins, Vaishya. So who followed them, like Shudras, etc.? The Telis, okay, of Orissa. They were engaged in oil extraction. After that, they started taking up various other occupations also and started to claim themselves higher. Similarly, Veldaras of South India is an example where they adopted Vaishya's way of life. Next is Shudra model. Okay, Shudra model, the caste that imitated the Shudras were mainly the Dalits. Okay, the Dalits are the ones who followed the Shudra model. Okay, so you have laundrymen of UP. Okay, is an example. So they were Dalits, they adopted the Shudras. Similarly, Bangis of Delhi. So what is the Shudra model? Shudra model means giving up, defying occupation, matlab dirty occupation, giving up dirty occupation or less dirty, taking up cleaner occupation. Okay, adopting Vedic rituals. All these were seen in the Shudra model. So example are the Dalits followed the Shudra model. Then M.N. Srinivas also observed that the Sanskritization was not just restricted to the Hindu, Hindu groups, but it was also seen outside the Hindu group also. So there were tribal models also. That means there were some castes which followed the tribes. Okay, in some places where like Bills, Santals or Todas, who were dominant in that region, like the Todas, they were dominant in Nilgiri Hills. Okay, where Bills and all in central India, they are dominant. So the lower caste in that particular region followed the tribals. So that is the tribal model. So the lower caste started to follow the Bills, the lower caste started following the Todas, okay, and started to claim themselves to be higher. You understood? So the lower caste trying to emulate the upper caste. If you observe all of this, you should understand now that whom they were trying to follow, they were actually trying to follow the dominant caste or group. In the previous class when we did dominant caste, I told you they act as a model of Sanskritization. That means in that particular region, the lower castes will follow the dominant caste. Okay, so he showed that there are different models. That means, okay, so M.N. Srinivas has observed that it is not only restricted to ritual following. Matlab, they don't just follow ritual factors, they also emulate or they also follow secular aspects also. Okay, secular aspect means like dress. Dress has nothing to do with rituals, but they start dressing up like the other caste. Okay, so secular factors also with it. Now, if we can group it into this, rituals. Now, various rituals, like whether it is in the marriage practice or whether it is any other ceremonies, they started to practice. Marriage ritual, funeral ritual, birth rituals, all these rituals, like wearing of sacred thread, the kind of marriage that is done, hiring the service of Brahmins for various rituals, all these were done. Emphasis on pilgrimage, going to temples and other sacred centers, all these were followed. That is ritual aspects. Then institutional change in the marriage. For example, change in the
marriage practice or change in the financial aspects of marriage. As I told you, in the lower caste there was bride wealth, okay, upper caste there was dowry. So they adopted a new institution of dowry. Then practice like child marriage, ban on widow remarriage. In lower caste there was widow remarriage was allowed, whereas in upper caste there was restriction. Okay, so the lower caste started to restrict widow remarriage.
Family structure,
lower caste, what kind of family structure do you see? Mainly nuclear family. Upper caste, joint family, which we had discussed. Yes, so now even the lower caste started to have joint families. Okay, so these were institutional. Next, secular aspects like dressing pattern, occupation, housing, the food you eat, all these underwent change. Secular aspects also were copied. Okay, so they started to follow. Like for example, even beetle chewing, okay, the punch, beetle chewing was restricted to upper caste. Okay, so lower caste started to follow this also as a as a part of Sanskritization. Okay, next, ideological aspect. So they started to follow various ideology like pollution and purity, okay, Rina theory or karma and Varna system. All these things were followed by them. Hell and heaven, all these concepts were followed. These were the ideological. Ideologically also they started to adopt the ideology of other castes. Is that okay? So these were the different changes that took place. Next, what were the factors that favored Sanskritization? One of the major factor, that is British rule, okay, and today democracy. Why? Because British rule and today's democracy allowed for change. Okay, it was not rigid, it allowed for change. So democracy introduced equality. Anybody can practice anything. I want to ride horse and go, I can do that. Okay, so Britishers brought in land reform. Democracy also brought in land reform, post-independence land reforms, etc. All this allowed for the lower caste to take up land, for example, and take up new occupation. Yes, taking up new occupation. Yes, they gave up their old occupation, started to follow the occupation of upper caste. Okay, democracy and British, they introduced jobs, okay, private jobs or government jobs, opened it to all castes. So the caste, they took up new jobs, gave them the new avenue for Sanskritization. Then increase in transportation and communication. Okay, so this helped them to learn about other castes, etc., provided avenue for cultural contact. Yes, increase in transportation and communication allowed for culture contact, because of which they were able to adopt their ways. Festivals and religious places and sacred centers. Yes, you remember sacred centers. So these sacred centers played again important role. Pilgrimage, you went to pilgrimage to these sacred centers, you learn the ways of upper caste, you come back and you start following that practice. Correct? Sacred centers, pilgrimage, festivals, all these things. Okay, then Western education. So this freed up, okay, or empowered the lower caste to do whatever they want to. Development programs, government development schemes and programs allowed them to take up new occupations, etc. These were not openly allowed also. There was resistance from upper caste also. So M.N. Srinivas and other anthropologists observed that the upper caste were not simply sitting, there were resistance. It even amounted to violence and killing of the lower caste. So upper caste tried to maintain their distance. Even when some of the caste tried to emulate, still they were not given that status. So outwardly they tried to change, but within the caste system they could not elevate socially. They changed their name, but they could not move up the social hierarchy. So they used, upper caste used political, economic pressure and sometimes even physical pressure. If you see news articles across India, the upper caste have tried to resist Sanskritization by lower caste. Okay, for example, the Thakurs resisted the Chammars when they tried to emulate. The Ahars were resisted, etc. So like that, you'll get number of examples where the upper caste tried to resist the process of Sanskritization.
So in that previous time you mentioned how
Correct. That is modern. That's next I'll tell you. So, in order to maintain their distance, they take up modernization. And modernization is too complex for the lower caste to understand. So, therefore, by this, the upper caste will try to maintain their distance. See what happens, upper caste, they will send their children to study in the study abroad. So, yet still they try to maintain that distance. So, now they will come back, they will act superior. Oh, you are still here, you own land. Oh my God. Okay. Still doing agriculture. Correct. No. Earlier agriculture means you are higher, upper caste. Now what has happened, they turned the whole definition of class. So that is how it is. That's what we will discuss next, modernization. Okay, next. Okay, so we'll try to evaluate this. Okay, one is, so on one hand, we see that many castes are trying to Sanskritize in order to move up the social ladder. But at the same time today, we see M.N. Srinivas or Yogendra Singh has observed that many of the lower castes are trying to retain their lower caste status. Okay, and sometimes the middle castes are trying to de-Sanskritize. Matlab, they are trying to follow the lower caste in order to take advantage of reservation. Neglected the existence of non-Indian model, matlab British model. Matlab, they are people following, or the lower caste follow the British. So he restricted this model to study only the Indian system. What about non-Indian model has not been explained. Okay, but again M.N. Srinivas says that he tries to explain this non-Indian model or non-Indian son through giving the concept of westernization. He later gives westernization to understand the caste following the British way of life. Okay, next. S.C. Dubey criticizes him, saying that a generalized all India model called as Sanskritization is not very useful. Okay, it is too general. You cannot be using this model to understand social mobility across India. Okay, rather he says that we should have model which is region specific. Okay, which takes into consideration the regional aspect. It's just a criticism. He says that instead of using word Sanskritization, we should use the word classical model, because Sanskritization narrows down the group you are studying, because not every social group derives their mythical and other aspects from the word from Sanskrit. Correct? No, there is regional languages which are used. Many Hindu communities, they don't follow per se the Sanskrit as a language. Okay, so he says instead we should use the classical model. Okay, so these are some criticism of the concept of Sanskritization. Is that understood? So who gave it? What are the different model? Why is it done? What happens? Ritual changes, ideological changes, secular changes, etc. Then what are the criticism of the concept? Is that understood? Okay, so you can write down.